You know, I'm in my tree stand this morning, and I'll be going out tonight for my birthday. My wife's carrying me out. We go to a town called Fayetteville. There's been a couple of times I've been approached by homeless, dope heads, crackheads, whatever you want to call them. And it's amazing how people deal with that situation. You know, there's three types of people in that situation. There's the kind that kind of take the defensive posture when they walk up. You know, they're asking for money, and you kind of just wait and see what they're going to say, even though you know what's coming. Then, of course, there's the popular Southern country boy way where you pull out your pistol and you just, can I help you? Is there something I can help you with? And that usually ends it pretty quick. They either say, don't kill me, don't shoot, or they just try and walk away. And then, of course, there's the payoff. There's the one that thinks, well, you know what? I'll just pay them out. And then I don't have to be involved with them, or I'll go buy them a hamburger or drink or something, and then feel good about it. But here's my whole point to what I'm saying. It's amazing how God will send you something in a deer stand to help you with a situation that you have been in before or may be in or can help someone else. So I want to help you today on how to deal with a dope head that comes asking for 10 bucks. How to deal with him. How do you deal with a dope head? A friend of mine sent me a text while I'm in my deer stand. Jesus said in Matthew, I think it's chapter 5, the scripture is what he sent me. He says, unless your righteousness exceeds those of the Pharisee and scribes, you shall in no way enter into the kingdom of heaven. And I just couldn't help but think about the attitude that I have toward people that are drug addicts or toward people that are destitute or poor. The way they come in and they bother me when they ask for money. I couldn't help but think, bother me? That's somebody's son. That's somebody's daughter. That's somebody's dad. That's somebody's mom. Somewhere something happened in their life. Maybe it was a car wreck that killed all their family and they just turned to drugs. Maybe their husband left them and went out on the street and become a prostitute and were hooked on drugs. Who knows what happened? But that's a person with a soul and a person that needs help. And that's someone that's reached out to us. And as a Christian today, the worst thing I can do is take a defensive posture, pull out my pistol, take out my wallet to pay them off just so they'll leave. That's the worst things we can do, because when we do that, we not only are sending them the wrong message, but we're sending them out back into the streets, back into the world with no hope, nothing but the hope of finding someone that's going to help them get their next fix. Peter and John were walking into the temple. When they were walking into the temple, there was a man laid at the gate. He was lamed. He'd been that, like that, I think, 40 years. And he says, can I have some money? I need something. I need something from you guys. Peter and John didn't have any money. They said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. The man jumps up, had strength in his legs, and went leaping and praising God, and they went into the temple together. What is the point of all this, I'm saying? The greatest miracle in the world is not healing somebody where they can walk again. It's not giving somebody their sight by touching and praying they receive sight. It's not people receiving their hearing because God has touched them. The greatest miracle that will ever happen in your life or anybody else's life is when something's dead, separated from God, is made alive and new by the power and the regeneration of the Holy Ghost of God. When He comes into a life and He makes someone that's separated and dead from God alive and new. And the only way that can happen is somebody's got to tell them about Jesus. Somebody's got to say, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, hung on a cross, shed His blood for me. And because He shed His blood all over the ground for me, on the golf course, January 18, 2003, I was born again, never to be the same. And you can have that same experience too. I know you're hooked on drugs. I know you think this is what your life's going to be and you're trapped. But I can give you hope, and His name is Jesus. And if you'll just give me just 5 minutes of your time, I'll take the time to tell you what He can do for you. But it's real easy for us to pay them off, scare them off, and then us walk up into church on Sunday morning and feel like we're something to God. Luke 18. Two people walked into the church, the temple. A Pharisee, a religious man, and a publican, a known sinner. The religious man stood at the altar. He says, God, thank you I'm not like an adulterers and the murderer. Thank you I'm not like that guy over there praying. I'm not like that dope head. Thank you, Lord, for sparing me that I'm not such a loser in life. But the Bible says he was praying to himself. He was bragging on himself to God. But the sinner, the publican, the Bible says he wouldn't even so much as lift up his eyes to heaven. He knew he was separated from God, and he was humble. He said, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. The Bible says, Jesus said, the one that was the sinner that humbled himself, he was the one that left justified. On this day, my 45th birthday, I just pray that something was said today to help you and help me, because what God spoke to my heart through that one scripture that friend of mine sent me while I'm in my deer stand has changed my whole outlook today. I can't wait to go to Fayetteville tonight on my birthday so I can witness to that dope head, that person that's going to come up to me and tell them about Jesus. God bless you. Have a great day. Please share this.